system of money. Could this come up? All right. You can just come over here. Open up here at the back. Thank you. Okay. Let's assume a scenario. He is doing business, and I am a money lender. Okay? I help other people by giving them money. So, she is doing business and she is in need of money, so she comes to me. Can I have some more? So, I'm going to give her 10 bucks. Okay? Now, she has gone home, she has done her business. I want to get the money back. Do we take my $100? I give you $100. Did you say, I give her $10, but I am saying, I give her $100. Right? Now, when I give her the money, obviously, you have accommodated somewhere. Right? So, you know, I could have written it in a notebook that I have given her some money. She would have written it in her notebook or maybe an Excel document that I have given her some money and how much money I have given her. Right? Now, both of us come to you, you are the judge. I am saying in my notebook, I have written that I have given her $100. She is showing you her notebook. Which says, I'm going to have 10. How do you decide who's right? There is no way you can decide because either one of us could be correct here. Right? But now, what we are going to do is, he's a very smart business person. He knows this kind of thing can happen. So, he will call her friend. Okay? So, when a friend comes in, I'm going to give her the money, and he will say, you are the witness. All right? You are the witness to this transaction. So I give her the money. I will write, I give her 100. She will write, I give her 10. And she will write what? I give her 10. Okay? Now give me that 100. So now I am asking for 100. The witness says she gave me 10. The witness says I gave her 10. If we come to you, who will you say that? He said, right? And why is that? Sorry? You, majority? Because of the majority, you know, decision, you are saying that? You have to come up with that. But I can do this. You are today, they were not going. This is the thing. Now I will write, I have given her 100. She will note down that I gave her 100. She will write down that she received 10. Now we come to you. Who will you say correct? You are incorrect. Right? So this is called consensus. Okay? Agreement on whether something is right or wrong. Now imagine you did not have access to this data, right? This transaction. You did not have access to it. But when I gave her this money, imagine all of you were witness to it. All of you wrote down that I gave her 10 bucks. But can I come and make a claim that you have given her 100 bucks? All of you, the majority of you, I'm going to say, I gave her 10. Right? Now, the way I influenced her, if I want to influence all of you, I better have a big pocket. Right? So, imagine the room that all the people in this room, you're all doing business with each other, you're sending money to someone, you're receiving money from someone, and there's a ledger in which we are making a note of all these transactions. And this ledger is visible to everyone in the world. Right? So
when you make a transaction, it's a consensus. It's an agreement on whether the transaction is valid or not. And if it is valid, then it is written into the ledger. Fair enough? That is a system which we call as blockchain. Okay? So blockchain is basically a ledger in which you write down transactions after consensus that this transaction is valid. Correct? Let me have a pen back. And give it a big hand, please. So when I said that blockchain is a ledger, if it is available with a lot of people, we call it as a distributed ledger. Because it is distributed. All the data is available with all of you in the room and with a lot more people in the world. So when we take a distributed ledger, it removes centralization. What I mean by that is that if you look at banks, what do banks do for you? They hold your money. They let you spend and receive money. Right? But if you have a distributed ledger, where once you put in a transaction, there is consensus, and after consensus, if you add this transaction into the ledger, you can no longer change it. Okay? If you try to change a transaction in a ledger, it will not be accepted by anyone because all of us can see this modification because there is a magic happening in the back end using mathematics and cryptography. Okay, so if you take one of these copies, try to change it and tell everyone, look, this is the right copy, you will immediately be able to make out that it is not the right copy. Okay, that magic, the ability to identify this happens through cryptography. So there was a lot of excitement when all these cryptocurrencies came into being, like, you know, Bitcoin, Ethereum, I'm sure most of you have heard of these things, right? So there was a lot of excitement because it could replace banks. But is that all there is to it? Are we just replacing the banking system and is that all the excitement behind blockchain? It's not. There's a lot more. There's a very important concept that came in 2015 called smart contracts. And smart contracts are the reason today that we believe it's going to change the way we do business in the future. So what exactly is a smart contract? Let me demonstrate it to you by asking you a question. Assume that there is unlimited budget. Okay, there is unlimited budget, and I have a question for you. Which car would you like to have? Louder, which car? Friends, not ambitious enough. I said there's unlimited budget. Rolls-Royce, yes. Maybe a Ferrari. But I'm not going to give it to you. Okay? You have to go and ask this to your parents. Alright? You have to go and ask this to your parents. I want a Rolls-Royce or I want a Ferrari. What will they say? Will they just give it to you? What will they say? You better clear the path and then we're going to give it to you. Right? Is that the standard answer usually in India? Right? Okay. So they agree. And the agreement is that if you score more than 99% marks, you get a Rolls Royce. Did you? Okay. Now you come to college, and suddenly you know your event organizer calls you, and says you have to organize TEDx. Right? And suddenly you realize, my God, I need to dedicate so much time to organizing this event that I'm not able to study. I will not be able to score 99%. But you still want the car. Right? So you still want the car. And you feel confident that maybe I'll not score more than 99%. I must score between 90% to 99%. So what will you do? You will go up to your parent and what will you ask? I must score 90% to 99%. Can I get that? Maybe a BMW. Right? From a right position, maybe I want a BMW. Okay? So are we coming to an agreement here? Right? Are actually defining the terms and conditions of an arrangement, right? So, you have the agreement that you score more than 99%, you are going to get an authorized. If you score between 99% and 99%, you get a BMW. Now, what's going to happen? You usually tend to ask for these things, not just before an exam. Maybe at the start of the term. Right? And then, when you get the money, after the exam, when the results come in, then you are not sure. You know, the standard thing that can happen is that, you know, when you ask for something to your parents, they will agree. And after a few months, the agreement will change. You may say, hey, I don't have to do it now, but I'll think about it. Right? So a lot of things can actually change here. You want to be sure that you'll get this money. I told you that you can do one thing. You can go to a third party. These third parties are known as escrow. So your parents will give them the money, and you create the agreement with them. When you do that, when your professor shares the market with you and shows it to the escrow, they will give the money either to you or back to your parents depending on how much you have scored. Right? The idea behind smart contracts is that it will replace this escrow. What it will do is a smart contract is a program which runs on a blockchain will put the terms and conditions. And then, your parents will send money to the smart contract. Not to any person, but to a program. And when you have this program, which is holding money, you need to tell the program at what point it needs to send the money to different people, either to you or back to your parents. So you define a simple function where your processor can go in and enter the marks into the smart contract. Okay? When they go and enter the marks, immediately it looks at the conditions of the contract and it will either send you the money or send the money back to your parents. Very simple concept, but it has a lot of powerful implications. Okay? It enables you to create something called as a token. For tokenization. Tokenization is short, you know, we call them blockchain, we call this as tokenomics. Token economics. So what exactly is token economics? What is a token? A token is something that represents an item of value. Can I say the currency in my pocket is a token? A rupee is a token? Yes. Can I say while the coins that you get when you do shopping is that a token? Yes. Can we say that the building is a token? Why not? Okay? Start thinking out of the box. What blockchain lets you do is it helps you represent any real world asset as a token, as a digital token. So you go out today and you look at a nice building, a very beautiful building, and you realize you don't have the money to buy it. What tokenization lets you do is represent that building as a token. So that you can buy a fraction of it. Okay? So if the building costs $1 million, you can actually buy a fraction that is worth just $50,000. And you get the right to use that building, let's say, you know, for a month in a year. And then someone else who's bought another portion of that token can use it for a month in a year. So you can actually take real-world assets and represent them as tokens on the blockchain. This is a very powerful concept. And what I'm speaking of is not something which is in the future. This is something that's happening today. There are people in the world today who are representing different assets as tokens on the blockchain and letting you buy and sell those things. Take another example. All of you have laptops or desktop computers, right? Are you using it all the time? Most of the time, your CPU is sitting idle, doing
if you're working, maybe you may be using just about 10% of the CPU, and maybe you've got 20% to 30% of the hard drive. Now imagine that you can convert the CPU power and storage based on your laptop as a kit. So if there is someone in the world who really needs a lot of power to do some work, like maybe do some artificial intelligence processing, he does not have the money to go ahead and buy, you know, a supercomputer. So what can he do? He can actually come and ask people to share their CPU power or storage space. So what you will do, as an individual who has this resource, you will connect to the blockchain network and say, look, I have this CPU power and hard disk space available to share. And when millions of you say that you have this to share, if I need this processing power for a short duration of time, I can give you reward in exchange for that power. And I can do this computation, which requires a supercomputer. Instead of a supercomputer, I can do this in a distributed manner in all of your machines. And in turn, what I pay for that will be much smaller than buying a supercomputer. And you will get rewarded for the service that you are sharing. Is this an interesting idea? Have you all experienced power cuts? Yes, I'm sure no one in this room can say no, you have not experienced power cuts. Right? The interesting thing is, you can actually go and put solar panels on top of your house. Right? If you feel that you are experiencing a lot of power cuts. Now, imagine if all your neighbors also put solar panels on top of your house. You start generating a lot of electricity. Okay? And when you generate this electricity, you can actually represent that electricity as a token and sell it to someone who may not be generating that electricity. So maybe in a neighborhood there's a business who needs electricity, and they don't want to depend on the central grid because they have a lot of power cuts. They can actually buy that electricity from you and pay you directly. So this concept is called decentralized energy. So what blockchain helps you with is to create self-sustaining decentralized ecosystems. So you don't have to depend on central organizations like banks or central power systems, power producing units. It really makes you independent. It's a very, very powerful concept. Have you heard that Facebook was hacked? Data was leaked? Right? You know, Facebook is an ideal example of centralization. You give your personal information to Facebook, and then when someone hacks Facebook, all your data is exposed. But imagine the same example, but that data is in your control. There is no central server, but that which Facebook is managing. Okay, all this information is in your control. You can choose right to share this information with someone else. This brings in a lot of privacy. Okay, it brings control in your own. And that is what blockchain enables you to do. It gives you a lot of power. It makes things cheaper because you are removing a lot of middlemen. It enables you to be decentralized, not depend on single parties. It makes things faster. So the model that we have today, when someone controls what you have and how you behave, changes to you being in control and you doing what? You being able to decide who can access your information. Do you really think about the internet when you use your emails and you know you browse to Facebook and Instagram on your phone? Do you really think about the underlying infrastructure like the internet? You don't think about it because it's become an everyday household item. It's a commodity. Blockchain is doing the same thing in a decentralized manner. We have a lot of applications that are not blockchain, where one day you will be using blockchain without even realizing that you're doing it. That is a real ideal utopian. Thank you.